Firstly, in relation to testing methods, I'm from an open source software team, and during the past half year, we have done a lot of work on resolving the dependence of a writing Golang language for functions for. And for example, we have developed the Golang disassembler for functions for. And we have fixed a lot of bugs inside the Golang assembler for functions for. And we are extending Golang assembly syntax for functions for. And so far, there should be no significant block for your guests to write Golang assembly for functions for. So today, I'd like to speak about optimizing Golang for high performance with assembly for functions for. And here, Golang means Go programming language, or Go in short. And they mix the using of this keyboard on the top, but actually the same thing. The talk is like some training session. I think we have in about 1 hour. First, I would like to introduce some benefits to do optimization with Golang assembly and its current status. And then I would like to speak of, in general about Golang assembly and mainly for its differences from conventional GNU assembly, in case you don't know about it. And then I'll talk about how to integrate Golang assembly into Go code. It's very important for GUI optimization. And then I'll show you three examples. Finally, I'll discuss the current work and the next steps. As for the benefits, obviously, if we write a Go assembly for answer 4, we can get the maximum performance provided by the underlying hardware by using some hardware specific instruction and vector instruction such as SIM instruction. In addition, if you get assembly code into Go code, you can still get the advantage provided by C Go. A big introduction to C Go. C Go is for Go language, just like the JNI for Java. With it, the Go code can call to native code directly. For example, if we implement a Go package to do the print, actually, we can write a Go file with some special feature as shown in 9.5 to import a pseudo package, C package. Actually, it's not a real package. Then the C Go will generate a lot of Go code and C code to do the context switching between the Go ABI and the C ABI. As you know, there are two different ABIs. For example, in Go ABI, most all parameters are passed on stack, but in C ABI, some parameters should be passed through a register for answers 4. So the C Go is responsible for doing the conversion between the Go ABI and the C ABI. And if you call C Go code, obviously there is overhead, runtime overhead to switch between these two different APIs. But if you write your assembly code, you don't get such overhead. Sometimes the overhead is cannot be ignored. For example, when we try to develop this example for ARM64 for GoNAM, at first we try to develop some Go code to use the C Go to code native this example. But we find that the overhead is big. For example, when we try to use the native code to native disassemble for C Go to disassemble some small executable files such as Hello World, it takes about several minutes. But if we develop the disassembler with Go language, the execution time is just 1 or 2 seconds. So the overhead by C Go is obviously not negligible. So back to the benefits. If we write Go assembly, then we don't have dependence on C Go, and we can still get the capabilities provided by native instruction. For example, for do a print, we can still write a Go assembly to do a system call directly instead of calling some native little C function. And the overhead is if we call C code, the overhead is big, but if we use Go and assembly, then the overhead is negligible. And obviously, we can get optimized code because currently Go compiler is still very simple, and we can also get a faster compilation. Since the Go and assembly code don't need the compiler. So here we list the current Go standard packages which can be optimized with Go assembly. As you see, a good place to use assembly is the crypto packages. And ARM64 actually has provided a lot of optimized instructions to do crypto. And we have optimized some of these packages, but it won't be an easy job for us to optimize all of them in a shorter time. And in addition, different people may have different optimization priority and according to their use cases. And if you are good at Go assembly after listening to this talk, you can do your own optimization to GoNet if you have specific requirement. Here we list the terminologies used on this talk. Mnemonic is the name of the GoNet assembly instruction. And for example, call or move. And for register, there are R register for general purpose register, F register for floating point register, V register for vector register. And bear in mind that in GoNet assembly, there is no partial register as shown by the left picture. There is no 32-bit W register in GoNet assembly. But there is such a register in GNU assembly. And instead, type suffixes are appended to the mnemonic to specify the width of the register. For our example, move W means operating on the 32-bit W register, and move D means operating on the double word register. For the immediate, which is the number encoded directly into the instruction, and for memory, the memory can be accessed with some addressing mode with a base register, and some offset, immediate offset, as shown by these two examples. So the goal line assembly originates from the plan 9 of Bell Labs, and it's a kind of semi-abstract instruction set. Somebody also call it a pseudo instruction set, because in the sense that there are many architecture independent mnemonics, like MOD, which is then translated to actual opcode for different architecture, or ARM64. If we move a value from memory to register, it's actually translated to the ALDI instruction. But if we move a value from register to memory, it's actually translated to STR instruction. And there are also some hard architecture aspects. For example, for Gona assembly for ARM64, it has a pre-indexed instruction and a post-indexed instruction. And the assembler may do some fine things, such as it can insert per lux to do stack check. For example, there are four instructions inserted at the very beginning of the function add to do stack at the run, stack check at the runtime. And you know the stack of go routine is dynamic, can grow dynamically. So if the product the product code finds that the current stack is not enough, then it will enlarge the stack at the runtime. But you may not be aware of the product because you don't need to write it. It is automatically inserted by the assembler. And the assembler can also optimize some unreachable instruction which no code can jump to. So in a sense, it's like a kind of high-level optimization conducted by compiler. But actually, it's just assembly-level optimization. And the instructions may be expanded by the assembler. So if you write some instruction trying to access something with big offset, then the assembler may insert some additional instruction to first move the address of the memory operand to some temporary register, but you may be not aware of it. So, in summary, Goldman assembly is more like a kind of semi-abstract instruction set. Goldman assembly is mainly developed to support compiler, so not all instructions you want to write are available now, but you can resort to directives such as byte, word, none to lay down the opcode directly into instruction stream. But we are trying to improve the situation by adding more instruction support to the assembler. Some of the patches have been merged. So hopefully one day you don't need to write opcode directly into assembly. So here's some basic introduction to the instructions of Go assembly. In Go assembly, data always move from left to right. But in GLU assembly, data always move from right to left. So for the first example, add R1, R2, it puts the result to R2 instead of R1. And many instructions for R64 have three operands, as shown by the example subtract. And for memory operand, if you see a register inside parentheses, just as shown by the first example, it means it dereferencing that register. And if you see any number near to that, it means you need to add the immediate offset to that register or that pointer. And for Go memory operand, the operand can also be some single length. In Go single length is very interesting. It has a weird middle dot, a weird interposed middle dot, splitting the packet length from the variable length. And the packet length is actually an option. If you just put it a variable length, it means the local variable of current packet as shown by our demo. And to guess the addresses of this memory operand, you just need to put a dollar sign in front of the memory operand as shown by our two examples. So, Go assembly currently is not defined very well for ARM64, especially for some ARM64 specific instructions, such as the critical instruction or SMD instruction. And we are trying to add some extension to Go assembly to make it work better for ARM64. The first extension is extended register. With it, you can combine some extension instruction or shifting instruction with some adding instruction into just one instruction as shown by our example. And we also add some extension to support arrangement and with space bar and element index for SMD instruction. With them, you can move some element of vector instruction into some general purpose instruction. And the extension also includes some support to register list and register offset as shown by our example. And since some mnemonics and operand of Go assembly for ARM64 are different from that of GLU assembly, and there are almost no documents for to describe the differences. So we are also writing some instruction reference menu to provide a reference for the user. For full details for the extension, you can refer to our page. We have provided a link here. So we have introduced the basic knowledge about Go assembly, and mainly is different from conventional one. But for Go unlike C programming, you cannot inline assembly directly into Go code. Instead, you need to prepare a separate file for the assembly. And the file should the file name should be dot s, should be with dot s file extension, and the OS and the arc identifier can be pretended to the assembly file name. So for our two examples, there are two assembly files for ARM64, and the one is for Linux, and the other one is for Darwin system. And to go back to our chain, we are select appropriate assembly file according to the target, the OS and the ARC. And the OS identifier is actually an option. So if you just put the ARC identifier, then it means that the assembly file is suitable for all operating systems supported by .NET. So as for our example of CRC32, actually, these assembly files are suitable for any OS. It's very interesting that it's OS independent. So if we implement a function in assembly file, then we need to declare it in Go code so that the Go compiler knows what the arguments it takes so that it can be called by Go code. So the function call is actually the bridge between the Go code and the Go assembly code. Here is an example for the function wartime. We declare its first type in the Go file, timestamp.go, just like the C declaration. But as you know, Go 9 supports multiple return value, which is not supported by C language. And we implement this function in a separate assembly file, SOS Linux ARM64.s. In this file, the keyword text signifies the start of the function implementation. And here we have, firstly have the package name, but it's actually optional. So if we just put the function name, it means that this function is for current package. Then we have the weird middle dot and following by the function name. For Go 9, all names of global symbols are actually offset from SB or static base, the title should register. So you just think that a name with SB means a global symbol or Go assembly. Then we have the function flag, which is also optional. The flag not literally means that the compiler or the assembler don't need to insert prolog to do stack check. Since this function is a list function and it has a very limited stack access, so it should be safe to disable stack check. And finally, we have two numbers. The first number is for the stack frame, which basically say how many bytes the current local variables take. And the second number is for argument size. Bear in mind that the argument size includes the size of return value. So as for our example, it has two return values. The first one is 64-bit integer, and the second one is 32-bit integer. So actually, we have 12 bytes in total. If we don't rewrite the argument side. It means that we disable the status check performed by go wait. Here is the pseudo register or a virtual register supported by Go 9. The first one is FP or frame pointer register for argument. Arguments always have a positive offset from the pseudo register FP as shown by the example. And we also have SP, stack pointer pseudo register for local variable. Local variables also always have a negative offset from FP, as shown by the example. But keep in mind that the pseudo register SP is different from the RSP, which is the physical register for ARM64. They are different, but both FP and SP will finally be translated to some offset at the RSP, physical register, and the offset is decided by the assembler. And we also have the SB, statute-based pseudo register for global symbol. And we have shown you one example about the SB. Here is the code convention for Go API. All arguments are passed on the stack, and the arguments can be accessed with offsets from FP. And the return arguments follow input arguments. The start of return arguments align to the pointer set, which is 8 bytes for ARM64. So for example, if we have a function with one word integer and one word return value, the argument size should be 9 bytes instead of 2 bytes because you need to consider the alignment. And all registers in Go 9 color set except some special registers such as ISP. So you cannot assume that the register values unchanged across function call. And you need to save the value before function call and restore it after function call if you want to reuse it across function call. This is the visualization of ARM64 stack frame of across function call. As you see, the reason why the arguments always have positive offset from FP is because that the arguments is going up, and the reason why local variables always have negative offset is because local variables always are going down. And on ARM64, there is a linker register for the return address. And when we do a function call, the return address is set at the bottom of the stack, as shown by the picture. So it is important to always use pseudo registers such as FP, SP, because it allows you to ignore this return addresses. If we decide later to insert something like a frame point here, you just ignore them. But if you write some code with offset plus physical register such as ISP, then you need to adjust the offset. So we recommend you always to use pseudo register for better flexibility and portability. We have introduced all basic knowledge about Go assembly, and then we will quickly go through three examples. The first example is for CRC32. The original implementation is based on pure Go. The algorithm is shown on the left side. It's based on the table-driven algorithm. As you see, the function has three arguments. The first one is the old CRC value. The second one is a pre-computed table for computing hash value. This third one is a slice of input bytes, and the newly computed hash value will be returned at the end of this function, this Go, this pure Go function. And the most CPU time is actually spent on 45, which will query the pre-computed table and return the hash value. Here we list our assembly implementation of the CRC32 function. Firstly, it moves the old CRC value to R9 at 9.11. And then it moves the base pointer of the input byte slice to R13 at 9.12. And the offset is 8, as shown by the right picture. And the length of the slice is put to R11. And for our optimization, we simply adopt specific instruction, CRC32CX, which will compute the hash value for 8 bytes at a time, instead of 1 byte in original Go routine. And new computed hash value is finally returned on the stack, as shown by 9.47, and the offset is 32. The offset from FP is 32, as shown by the right picture. So here is the result of the assembly optimization, and it can get 2 to 7 times speed up, depending on the input buffer size. The larger is the input buffer, and the better is the performance speed up. The second example is for SHA-256. The SHA-256 is to compute secure hash for some message. So firstly, a little introduction to the SHA-256. The message is firstly split into some blocks of 512 bits. And for each block, there are 64 rounds of hash value computation. For each round, it has three input. The first one is the word generated by message schedule. The second one is the hash value computed by previous round of hash value computation. And the third one is a constant. So obviously, most CPU time will be spent on this 64 rounds of hash value computation. So here is the original Go version of message schedule. As you see, for the first 16 messages. The messages give you a word. There are actually some compilation of the original message input bytes, and for the following 48 words, they are computed with some operations such as shuffling, XOR, and addition, which are very time-consuming. But ARMsys4 has provided some hardware-specific instructions to do the work. As you can see, we just need two instructions to compute four words for message schedule. Of course, the code in yellow color are actually pseudo code. As for the final hash value computation, here is the original PureGo implementation. As you can see, for the 64 rounds of hash value computation, it takes for each round it takes the message input bytes and the word generated by message schedule and some constants value as shown in 999. And ARMsys4 also provided two specific hardware instructions to do the job. And as you see, two specific instructions can compute the hash value for four rounds of SHA-256. So if we put them together, we have such the code list here. We interlace the message schedule and the hash value computation for better performance. Here is the final result for SHA-256 optimization with assembly. As you can see, the optimization can get 2 to 16 times speed up depending on the input buffer. The larger is the input buffer and the better is the performance. The last example is to use SIMD instruction to optimize the function index byte. The functionality of index byte is to search some specified byte, the target byte, in a slice of bytes. So this function is already implemented with assembly, but it's very simple. As you see in 9814, it moves the length of the slice to R1, and in 9.13, it moves the target back to R0. And it used the the target byte is moved to R2 as shown in 9.8.15, and they use the R0 as the pointer to do the search, and R1 is used as the sentinel. So in original implementation, it just compare the target byte, which the elements of the slice one by one. And if the target byte is found, its index is returned. Otherwise, -1 is returned. So our core idea to optimize this function with SIMD instruction is to use the instruction CMDQ, which can do the comparison in parallel for 16 bytes. So the 16 bytes of the input slice are firstly loaded into VM, a vector register M, and the target byte is duplicate the VN, the vector register N. And this instruction, we are set every bit of the encoding element in VD to 1 if the comparison is equal. Otherwise, if we are set every bit 0, as shown by the example. But there are more details for consideration. If the input slice are shorter than 16 bytes, how can we handle it gracefully? And if the address of the slice is not 16 bytes aligned, how can we handle it? And if the size is not aligned, and how to quickly count the training error as shown by the picture. Since the time is limited, we just provide the link to our text for the SMD instruction. Or if you are interested, you can refer to it for more details. And the SMD optimization can get up to 8 times speed up, as shown by the picture. So here we list all the patches we have submitted to the upstream so far. And as you can see, some is for the disassembler, Golang disassembler for ARM 64. And some are for the assembly. And we have also done some optimizations with SMD instructions and some crypto instructions. We have also optimized the Golang compiler SSA backend for ARM 64 for some memory operation. And we also done other improvements to Golang runtime, such as enabling the frame point. And most of these patches have been merged. So as for the next steps, we will continue to optimize the crypto instruction since networking is one of the domains Golang works on. We will continue to optimize some basic packages such as strings, size, runtime, and reflect with SIMD instruction. And we also will make some further optimization to Golang compiler SSA backend. As I know, there are also some developers from university doing similar optimizations to ARM 64 backend. That's very good. And there are also a lot of other things to do, such as improvement, tools enabling for ARM 64, and new architecture feature support. As you know, ARM architecture is evolving constantly and recently. So I think that's all. So thank you for your attention. Thank you.